This week, we have one tough cowboy who has made it from death's door to become one of the top performance acts in the world. And Chad writes with trainer Cleve Wells. Rodeo originated with occasional gatherings of cowboys wanting to show one another who was best and quickly evolved into an organized sport with a host of specialty acts in the mix.
How about the One Arm Bandit?
One such act has been around the globe entertaining crowds for nearly 30 years.
Didn't get a lot of done, but sure had a lot of fun. And that's how I live my life.
Why the name One Arm Bandit?
I was killed back in 73. I was working for my dad on a ranch, and he bought a house, and we'd worked there 6 days, and I was tearing down the house, and I climbed up the pole to cut the wires down and went to the house and grabbed a hold of 7200. I thought it was dead. Right before I grabbed it, it shot a spark to me and made my hands close around it. And it was just like that for 10 seconds, and it burnt through my fingers and fell to the ground, 25 foot. And then I was dangling alongside the pole, and it burnt my leg to the bone for about a foot right in there. You see the bone. And I went and cut my leg off, and I said, you know what, I'm a cowboy, and I ride horses. It's going to be a little bit tough riding a horse with one arm and one leg. I said, long story short, we're not going to cut the leg off. You cut the arm off, get rid of it, it's about to fall off. But the leg will stay. And they said, well, it'll kill you because you got infection in it, and you got infection in your arm, you're going to die of infection. But they didn't know how tough I was. And pretty tough and hard to kill. And they cut my arm off, and that's why they called me the One-Arm Bandit. And went home and started breaking a horse, and he reared up and pawed me right in the shoulder. He ripped me open, and I bled like a stuck hog all the way to the house, hobbling around. Of course, my mom wasn't very happy with me. And I'm a cowboy, hardcore, redneck, oaky cowboy, through and through. And that's all I am, that's all I wanted to be, and I'm very happy being that. I don't take anything for nothing, don't take things for granted. I want to earn everything I get, I want to earn it. I don't want nothing easy, and I don't care if I got a bunch of money in the bank or not a bunch of money in the bank. I want to live my life happy. And be healthy. It don't make any difference how much money you got. If you're unhealthy, what's it going to do for you? So by riding my horses and doing the show and hustling and struggling and moving and just all this that I do keeps me strong, healthy, and happy. Well, that's all you get out of life. Mm-hmm. It's a pretty big waste if you die with a bunch of money in the bank. Never give up. Never give up. There's a way of doing everything. And when they cut my arm off, I didn't know what was going to happen, but I can do anything I want to do with this hand and this arm. If I can't do it with this hand and not that arm, it don't need done.
You have just watched the One Arm Bandit at work.
Don't ever give up. If our forefathers would have gave up, we wouldn't have the United States. And if they hadn't gave up, we'd still be living east of the Mississippi. But it's due to people that's got a little backbone and cowboy ingenuity that got this world where it's at today. And I'm just a descendant of all those people.
He tells us how the act got its start.
Used to gather wild cattle for a living. Had good dogs. Went several different states gathering wild cattle. And most of them would be for half of what I caught, or $500 a day or $100 a head or whatever. old boy Walter Allsball bought a bunch of bulls off my dad. And we didn't think they could pin them, and we sold them to them in the pasture, and they couldn't pin them. So I had to come and pin them. Went to the rodeo to watch them buck. Of course, I hadn't been in town 3 weeks. Probably drank a couple beers too much. And when the act came out, I said, "Boy, that sucked." And Walter turned around, came back over and said, "We'll just let you be the entertainment next year." So I said, "I'll be here." And I knew I was good with dogs. I knew I was good with horses. And I knew I had a little cowboy ingenuity, and I was determined, and I had some talents. I came back the next year and put 5 quarter inch steers up on a homemade trailer. So that's how we got started.
It's a beautiful day. Oh yeah.
I trained buffaloes, I trained mules, I trained big Texas longhorn, got the biggest horn you've ever seen. Recently I started training zebras and z-donks and zorses just for something different. Buffaloes are the toughest son of a guns in North America. A bad bull out of the swamps of the Everglades in Florida can't hold a candle to a buffalo. They like a good fight, and they can fight for a long time. That's how come there are 60 million of them. Tough son of a guns. Cattle ain't near as tough as a buffalo. Then most of your horses ain't near as tough as your mules. I got a tough mule in here. Dirty, rotten son of a gun. Run off with you, buck you off. He's bucked me off 3 times during the performance. One time kicking me in the arm, knocked my arm off during the show. One time he fell off top trailer and knocked me out. But my little outlaw horse, I'm real proud of him. I was at a horse sale. Killer buyer buys me for $300. When the sale's over, I put $320 in my pocket and walk up and hand it to the guy. He said, "Well, heck, I give $300 for him." I said, "You've already made $20 and you ain't even touched him." He said, "I'm a little tight tonight, so you can have him." So I brought by outlaw. This horse in here just loves me and wants to be nice to me and get along. The mule is always sitting there thinking, "What's this?" But not all mules are like this. I bought a renegade mule. And me being a one-arm bandit, a little bit of a renegade anyway, we get along pretty good. And the outlaw horse, $300 killer horse.
John tells us about the highlight of his career.
No doubt about it, going to Oman, O-M-A-N, and doing a show for the king, where there was several acts, several entertainers. Money was no object. They hired the best. They circled the globe for 5 years, finding the very best to come back and show their king. We was invited, and after 6 rehearsals, the American team got to go last. And you know what that means when you get to go last. So we got to go last.
The highly renowned Royal Equestrian Festival features the best international equestrian acts from a dozen nations and is considered among the highest honors for an artist to be invited to perform.
It took 18 head of animals. 9 people went. Truck and trailer went. Truck and trailer went on boat. The animals all flew on airplane. And it's halfway around the world. And we got to see a different culture and meet different people and got paid for it. And heck of a vacation.
I want to hear it from one of the greatest guys that I've made. Let's do it. What an awesome band.
Chad talks Western Pleasure with trainer Cleve Wells.
You know, Western Pleasure, where do you see it going in the future?
You know, Chad, it's a very strong event. You know, it is one of the more popular events in the industry. I kind of call it an entry-level event. Not everybody lives in the area where they can have a roping pen. And if you didn't grow up riding horses, it's tough to go be a roper or run down the fence and fence a cow or something and to develop your motor skills to that. So it's a popular class because it is a lot of fun to do. I'm gonna agree with everybody. It's not the funnest thing to watch all the time, but it is fun to do. If you try to do it and do it right, it's a lot of fun. first thing we want to do is just kind of touch it, just find the horse, the bars of the horse's mouth. Just kind of touch. All right. And then just kind of stay as relaxed as you can. Just relax in your hips and everything, your legs. Okay. All right. And you got his head down. Just touch him and try to hand one hand off to the other. Just touch, you know, left, right, left, right. In the pleasure, you don't want to interfere in a horse's stride, but what we want that horse to do is get soft. We just want him to be soft. Just left, right, just barely float that snaffle through his mouth. The trot is usually an easier gait to train a horse in because it's a two beat. And it's a little bit easier. It's, the horse has got a little bit more forward motion. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times when we're teaching horses things, we teach it in the trot.
It's a beautiful day.
The pleasure horse, the breed itself is a soft horse. You know, the perception that every horse can walk, trot, and lope, so every horse can be a pleasure horse, that's not true. Mm-hmm. Every horse can run, they're not race horses. So we find a horse that wants to decelerate. A horse that when you turn him loose, he wants to come back to you, but when you really think about it, Chad, that's a good horse in every event.
Sure, yeah.
You know, there's an old saying, you know, when you're pushing, you're winning. When you're pulling, you're losing. And so we all want a push horse, a drive horse. And the pleasure's the same way. It's just an extremely soft event. But in that, we also have to have self-carriage. That's a horse, I call it kind of like equine ballet. It's a horse that wants to get really soft with as much stride, as natural stride, but yet have lift and self-carriage. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of just basic horsemanship to it, you know, and like I said, keeping that horse with your hands right here, to me, what I like to see, Chad, is I like to stay with my horse right here because I'm showing him what to do all the time. To me, that works better for me than riding like in and out a whole lot. Quit that, stop that, don't do that, get over here. Well, clarify, don't do that, get over here, where is here? You know, and so by riding, and that's the fear of a lot of people, is they don't want to stay that close to a horse's mouth and stay close to his sides. But as they become more educated in just what we're doing here today, they get more comfortable with staying closer. And when they stay closer, they're going to get more done with their horse. Because I tell people, the longer, the looser this rein is out here and we're kind of doing this, that's like one in three. All right, when I come in here like this, we're getting to be dance partners. That's like one in two. The closer I ride with my hands and my feet, we're like one in two. The longer these reins get and the more I open my feet up, now I'm like one in four. You know, so it's real choppy to both of us. And I said, out here in this training pen, I want to be like one in two. I want to dance all day. I want to dance with this horse, right close with this horse, and minimize his mistakes and maximize his positive steps, whether it be a spinning the reiner or a stopping or a cutter, you know, maximize his performance by minimizing the mistakes. If you ride away from him too long and you just dictate mistakes, You're going to grow away from your horse. And then you want to bring it back together in the practice pen here. So what I do when I trot my horses, or what I call transition, lope or trot or anything. If I want to trot, I'll wing my legs just a little bit, my calves, but I also kind of set up and bounce in that saddle sometimes. Like if I ask my horse to trot, I don't add more kick and more pressure. A horse can feel a fly. So why kick harder when you're patting him on his sides? If a fly gets on his ear, he'll mess your day up.
Yeah.
You know, so don't tell me you don't feel it. So that's why I'm like, that's the first sign, to me, that's the first sign of disrespect, is if I have to start kicking too hard to make something happen.
So should I wait on him?
Yeah, let him do it. The thing about pleasure is not horsemanship. I'm interested in the manner, the quality in which that horse trots. It's not about a now class. Uh-huh. So when you ask him, like I'm going to ask my horse, you're going to see my legs wing just a little bit. Uh-huh. Now I'm going to bounce on his back here, trot. Wing a little bit, trot there. See, and then he kind of comes up in under me. I'll continue to ride real close with the calves of my legs right here. One, two, one, two. Every horse is going to be a little bit different, whether he's fresh or tired or, you know, just the texture of a horse. Uh-huh. But I try to use a very soft cue and then get that horse to come to that.
Ah, look.
There you go. Just real soft. Just always think about this. A lady's got to ride this horse, a youth kid, a novice, you know. So as a professional trainer, I can't use Cleve's strength, and shouldn't, to make something happen with the horse. There you go. Just, we're not out here showing. You know, sometimes people they'll pick us apart a little bit. And I say, look, this is the practice pen.
Right.
We're not supposed to. You show me somebody that practices pretty, and I'll show you somebody I can beat this weekend.
Right.
You know, we're supposed to get out here, touch this horse's face, touch his sides, and work on some problems.
Okay.
And see that horse, you look in his ears, you look in his eye, you've got his attention. He's right there. He's between your legs. He's between the bridle reins. And he's saying, yes, sir. Yes, sir. What do you want? What do we want to do here? He's in the practice pen. We'll profile it all out and make it pretty when it gets to be that time.
It's a beautiful day. Oh, yeah.
And now the next thing I'll do, Chad, is I'll find like I use the left front, left, 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 right, left. Because what happens in a Western pleasure class is one, I don't want to be the person in the class who just tries to be the slowest horse.
Right.
I don't want to be the slowest horse. I'm not trying to show against the other 10 or 15 or 20 that are in the class. I want to exhibit my horse as to what I have as an individual. The way that you do that is you learn your horse's rhythm. Go ahead and trot that horse around again. And you learn your horse's rhythm a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, go ahead and ask him to trot, step him up. And as soon as he trots, oh buddy, left, 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 right, left. That's what I find. Just keep trotting around me here. Left, 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 right, left. All right, now, if you practice that all week at home and you get that in your mind, left, left. All right, now soften him just a touch with your hands. Left, 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 right, left. And you get that rhythm. Then when you show, you don't have to say, hey, did my horse speed up? You find that rhythm. Left, left. Hell, I'm right on.
Right.
I'm right where I need to be because I'm where I practiced all week.
Right.
So that builds confidence, and you know from being, you know, in your cowboy days, confidence is everything.
Sure.
Knowing where you're at, knowing that you're in the right place. Now, whether you're having to pass horses or not, that's irrelevant. Know that I'm doing what I practiced. Now, if I need to go back to the drawing board, we'll go home and go back to the drawing board. But today, my horse is good because that's the exact rhythm that I practiced all week at home.
You know, that's actually a great bit of advice, what you just said, because, you know, when I was rodeoing, I couldn't worry about the other guys and what bucking bulls or horses they drew.
Right.
I can't control them.
Right.
I can control me and what horse I had to ride.
Exactly.
So, you know, I was already beating myself if I was worried about what everybody else is getting on.
You're trying to beat them. So that kind of does that. The same thing, we'll move this horse up in a lope. A transition is something you think about. All right.
Okay.
So you put your right leg on and just barely take that left leg off. And then when you get ready to lope, just lift up in the saddle and maybe even smooch a little bit. Tap your left rein just a little bit. Keep his head. I don't want to make you feel like no first grader. There he goes. There he goes. But see, he's just not sure. There
right.
you go. He's just not sure. So rather than make a mistake, he's going to be a little sluggish. Left. Left. All right. Then we find that rhythm right there. Now the next thing, just keep loping a little bit. One, two, look around. Who's in front? Who's behind? What's the judges looking at? You know, where are you at in the pen? Run your traps, but run them in the rhythm so that when you come back, you're right there. Fall right back. And I think that would stand if you was running a fast circle or a slow circle on a rainer or whatever.
Uh-huh.
Think with you, because think in the rhythm that you're moving, so when you come back, you fall right back into place. Because you want to have positive practice, but yet you want to maintain that 1 and 2 close workout out here in the warm-up pen.
Today's tip is brought to you by Assault One Tire Production.
We go to a horse show or a rodeo or whatever it is that you're going to. It would be pretty heartbreaking to be stuck on the side of the road, tying your horses to the trailer in, say, downtown Dallas.
You know, flats never happen in a good place. We've alleviated that with Assault One by treating the tire as preeminent to a blowout or a flat. There's 17 different fibers, and at the moment of a puncture, all those fibers come together and immediately and permanently seal the tire from loss of air pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest thing from the time we get them in the round pen all the way through to we're getting on them as their 2-year-old year, is the first thing they learn is whoa.
Right.
When you say whoa, it means I don't care what you're doing, trotting, walking, loping, turning around, when whoa it comes out, you stop doing whatever you're doing. And that's a very, very, very important part of the basic training of, I think any horse.
Sure.
You know, you get in trouble riding one around or get in trouble doing anything, you say whoa and they stop, at least you can regroup.
Right.
You know, so that's, and then when we bring them from the round pen out to here, you're loping around and you say whoa to them, and I don't care how they stop, as long as they stop.
This week's tip has been brought to you by Assault One Tire Protection. For information on how Assault One can prevent blowouts in your tires, go to their website, assaultone.org.
Incorporate it into what you want as an individual for your horse.
All right, well, I'm going back to ranch. I'm going to try it still.